all of you here in present.
Oh, no.
And certainly we welcome all of those who may be joining us on a very special day as we share in this next step for all of these youth. And certainly I want to take a moment to say thanks to all of the mentors. Actually, they're all outside. Thank you, mentors. To all of the family members, too. It's such a great privilege to be a part of all of that. Ian is going to join me in assisting with this. Ian has been here since most of these were, he probably baptized many of these kids then, too. So it's great to have Ian be a part of this vision service as well. I want to share just a couple of very brief announcements then. Next weekend, we actually begin our summer worship schedule. So we still have a 5:30 worship service on Saturday nights. And then our Sunday morning service, we have 8:30 worship and a 10 o'clock worship. So do make note of that. We begin our summer worship schedule next weekend. Next weekend, we will also recognize all of our graduates from high school and post-high school education and training. Let's take a moment to support all of our kids. Want to mention, too, June 8th, last opportunity for you if you'd like to be a part of the June Fellowship Luncheon. It's at Lakeside Skillet in Harvey's Lake. If you would, contact Jen Metzger. Jen was one of our ushers. There you go. Great way, Jen. Okay, or Clydette Wagner. Clydette, we'll bring it back to you. Contact one of them if you are willing and want to be a part of that. Again, it's 12 o'clock noon on Wednesday, June 8th. June 9th, the King's Brass Concert at Shavertown at 7 o'clock p.m. You may know that if you'd like to be a part of that. I think there's a free will offering that's being taken to help offset that cost. Any other announcements that we need to share? Obviously, any of the confirmation families are welcome to take as much time as you want to afterwards for any kind of pictures, things like that. We did take a picture of the group over in the fellowship hall and also on the front steps. So we'll make sure that everybody gets copies of those. But just to let you know, you take your time after the service and take as many pictures as you want. Any other announcements? We're going to continue our worship service. Dan, would you be willing to ring the bell, please, as we begin our worship service here today?
Thank you.
is brought in as our confirmants and mentors process, we're going to stand and sing, O Spirit of the Living God. The words will be on the screen. If the notes matter to you, they're in the red hymnal, number 539.
on behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, answer, I do. With more enthusiasm. Do you accept the freedom and power that God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, answer, I do.
I do.
Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and race? If so, answer, I do.
I do.
And according to the grace given to you, will you remain faithful members of Christ's holy church and serve as Christ's representatives in the world? If so, answer, I will.
I will.
As you look at these faces, there are questions for you this morning as well. My friends, do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? If so, answer, we do.
We do.
That was enthusiasm. Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include these persons before you in your care? If so, say, we will.
We will.
Now I ask you to join me in this affirmation on the screen up here as a congregation. With God's help,
we will proclaim the good news and live
according to the example of Christ.
We will surround these persons with a community of love and forgiveness, that they may grow in their trust of God and be found faithful in their service to others. We will pray for them,
that they may be true disciples who walk in the way that leads to life.
Amen. And now let us join in affirming our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day He rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints,
the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body,
and the life everlasting. Amen.
So each of the confirmands will come one at a time, and they'll kneel at the kneeler. If there are some of you as family members that want to come up to be a part of that, please feel free to do that. All of us will certainly pray for them. Remember your baptism and be thankful. Paige, may the Holy Spirit work within you that having been born through water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. And all God's people said.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Spirit work within you, that having been born through water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. And all God's people said. Remember your baptism and be thankful. Greedy, may the Holy Spirit work within you, that having been born through water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. And all God's people say. Amen. Jacob, remember your baptism and be thankful. Jacob, may the Holy Spirit work within you, that having been born through water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Cody Reinhammer, remember your baptism and be thankful. Cody, may the Holy Spirit work within you, that having been born through water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ.
Within you, that having been born through water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. And all God's people say. work within you, that having been born through water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Remember your baptism and be thankful. And Tyler, may the Holy Spirit work within you, that having been born through water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. And all God's people said,
Amen. Amen.
Members of Christ Universal Church, will you be loyal to the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries? If so, answer, I will. And as members of this congregation, the Trustville United Methodist Church, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayer?
Members of the household of God, I commend these persons to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love. And let's share this promise together.
We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in the church of God, as members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation. The Trustville United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant to faithfully participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ.
I'm going to invite the mentors, if you would, to stand and move out of the way. Let's show our appreciation for all of these folks. And I trust that you'll have occasion to greet them, to meet them, to reach out to them at some point in time in the very near future, just to welcome each of them as members of the Trustville United Methodist Church. Let's pray. Lord God, again, we thank you for the privilege of gathering here, sharing in this time together. Lord, we ask your blessing upon all of those who are being confirmed today, for all of their mentors, for all of their family members, and Lord, to each of us as members of Christ's holy church, Lord, may we recommit our lives to you. Do all that we can to live as one of your faithful disciples in the world today. For these things, Lord, we do ask in your name. Amen. Feel like this, everybody. Take a good deep breath. Time to invite our children to come. We'll gather up here around the steps as much as we can. You guys sit right here. Thank you, everyone. Oh, yes. That's all right. I'm glad the kids are up here then, too. We have a special tribute today, too. So, Bobby Bear, wave your hand, Bobby. Bobby Bear. Bobby had approached me some time ago and said that he would like to dedicate this song. So he and Dr. Steve recorded it ahead of time. The song is Here I Am. We're going to listen to it this time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Here I am, Lord. Use me. Bobby, thank you very much. Dr. C, appreciate that. Thank you. Well, folks, it's not going to be long until some of you are right up here. I hope that was an awesome experience for you to see some of your older siblings and some of the people that you know from this congregation sharing this time together. Well, I want you to know that I love to play games. Any of you like to play games? Now, I'm not talking video games. You're having trouble with video games. Oh, you like to play the game trouble. I got you. All right. Yeah. I thought you were having trouble with video games. Very good. Board games are the games I really like to play them too. And one of my favorite growing up, and the truth is I still kind of like it. Ever played that game before? Chutes and Ladders? So what's the object of Chutes and Ladders? Go ahead. Go ahead, either. Yeah, you're trying to get to the very end, right? And you're trying to avoid which ones, the chutes or the ladders? The chutes, yeah. By the way, just as an aside, I found this out, that the game originated in England, and it was called Snakes and something else. So the chutes were actually snakes, but the children didn't really like the snakes too much, so they changed it in the United States to chutes and ladders. So, what's the ladders do? Go ahead. They take you up, right? So maybe you're on square 4 and you hit a ladder, and now all of a sudden you're up on square 21, right? And then what's the chutes do? Send you right back down. And you know, if I remember correctly, there's a ladder right towards the very beginning of that game that takes you really, really, really high. Maybe even up to the top row. But there's also a chute right near the end that takes you where? All the way back down. Yeah, I remember that. I think I hit that chute quite a bit. But the great thing about that game is you never give up because you never know what's going to happen, right? About that game, because I think that it seems a lot like our lives. You know, we are challenged really to never give up. There are times in our lives where it's just like a ladder and we're lifted high and we feel good about where we are. And then there are other times where we go through challenges in our lives and it's just like the chute just threw us way back down to the beginning again. Our lives are really kind of this high and low. But there's a big difference between the game of chutes and ladders and the game of life. Because in the game of life, when we're journeying through, we journey knowing that we are not alone. Just had a scripture passage a couple of weeks ago where Jesus said, I will never leave you alone. I will never leave you orphaned. And he promised us the Holy Spirit who would be with us forever. And so that's something I want you to remember on this day. That no matter what we go through in life, whether it's the ladders and feeling good about where we are, or the chutes and going through difficult challenges, we are never alone, but God is with us each and every step of the way. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for your promise in our lives to never leave us alone. We thank you, Lord, for sending your Holy Spirit into our lives. And we thank you, Lord, for being with us each and every step of our journey. Lord, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your presence. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a great day. Thanks.
Something else about that game, as I was sitting there listening to what Jay was sharing, it ain't called chutes and escalators, right? Chutes and ladders. You still got to work. You still got to climb the ladder. So you got to make sure the ladder is leading on the proper wall. But we do not do it alone. We have mentors and friends and family. And most importantly, we have God's Spirit with us every step of that journey. Part of that journey are the joys and the concerns that we share as family, as friends, as a church family. We give thanks for annual conference, which just concluded. Pastor Jay, Jill Kristen, and Ned Vesmer were our representatives in Hershey for these 3 days, and you'll have a chance in the weeks to come to hear a little more about the work that was done there, the next steps in our journey as a conference and as a church family. Spend a lot of time talking about next steps with our conference, and we are thankful for each and every one of you, for your mentors, for your families. We are thrilled to see what your next steps in your journey will be. Some more next steps. Our own Bill Bachman has been appointed as a lay surgeon to serve the Pittston and Old Forge congregations starting in July. So pray for Bill and for Gail as they continue their journey. And as Jay mentioned in the announcements, our graduates, we honor all of our graduates next weekend in worship together. We have ordination service and annual conference. So John Bondus and Todd and Christine were both ordained. They are friends of Pastor Jay's. Todd was a mentee and a former youth at the Bald Eagle Parish, where Jay had served in the past. And John and his wife Stephanie celebrated the birth of their daughter Margot this past week. So it's a big week for the Bondus family, to say the least.
So I served as John's mentor. John used to serve at Clark Stream United Methodist Church and then moved to Wellsboro. John and his wife had been trying for years to have a child, and finally she became pregnant. And then she discovered that her due date was the same weekend as John's possible ordination. And of course, that happened. She had a baby, but it was actually the Saturday before ordination, and she brought along baby Margot to the ordination service. And the bishop pointed out she was probably the youngest one that was there. What a neat experience for all of them.
So we celebrate those next steps in the journeys of those families and of our church. And yet all of those joys happen in the midst of pain and struggle. We look at the world around us, we see the hurt, the hate, the harm that has happened so often and far too often recently. Shootings in Buffalo and Texas and Oklahoma. Just last night, in a place that my daughter and I spent a good bit of time with, a student at Temple, on South Street in Philly, 3 people were killed and 13 were wounded in an active shooting situation. My friends, as the church, we need to lead the way. We need to be better because we are better and we know better. We pray for the people of Ukraine. We pray for the people of Russia. That's the hard one, right? It's easy to pray for the folks in Ukraine. We need to pray for the folks in Russia and their leadership as well. We pray for all those who have experienced the loss of a loved one. For Diane Roche and family and the death of her grandson, Christopher. For Pastor Kathy Wilcox, her father passed away this week. And for the family and friends of Reverend Paul Geer from South Montrose. We'd ask you to remember those in our congregation that are homebound. Irma Harris, Jeanette Nolan, our retired clergy and spouses, Reverend Ken and Jimmy Carter, Reverend Chuck and Vi Gomer. All of the clergy and congregations at our annual conference and annual conferences around the country and around the world who are getting ready to say goodbyes and hellos in new places, meeting old friends. Keep those churches, those pastors, those families in your prayers. We continue to pray for Madeline, and we're thrilled that Madeline is here with us this morning, worshiping and celebrating. We are so thankful for your continued healing. All of those from our extended church family, Daniel McNulty, Tim Burdick, Betty Lowry, Brian and Chris Michael, Bill and Susie Jones, Rob and Brenda McCauley. That's just this list that's printed here. There's a longer list that goes out in all the things that Aaron puts together in
sends out. There's all the things you all know that we don't know that are going on in your lives and the lives of family and friends.
Let's take a few moments and lift all of that
together in prayer this morning.
Almighty God, you came today
from so many different places in so many different ways,
praying
that your Spirit would fall afresh on us, on these 11, who today claim the faith that was promised to them long ago for themselves this morning. Lord, be with them as they listen for your voice, as they follow your footsteps into what's next.
Lord, we've come to celebrate so many things.
An annual conference in person for the first time in 3 years, where friends could gather to do the business of the church, but to learn and to worship. And we give thanks for Jay and Jill and Ned and their faithful work in that place. For new beginnings, as Bill and Gail get ready to serve those two churches. For new life and new ordinations, new callings. Lord, we give you. Where it's dark and it's twisty, where the path is uneven or broken, where there's rivers in the way or sheer rock walls that we don't know how to climb. And we've come today too, because we know it's only that Spirit that can guide us and guard us. Maybe you're calling us to sit there and wait for a bit. Maybe you're calling us to backtrack a little bit, look for a new path. Maybe we just need to ford that river that's in front of us.
Lord, whatever it is, we are going to trust you.
From the mountains up to the valley and back up again. Because you are faithful. You have promised to never forget us or fail us or forsake us. You've told us that you have a plan for our futures, a plan, a future filled with hope. With our whole heart. We've got work to do.
So help us to seek you today
with every bit of that heart. Knowing our salvation is assured, not that we're going to earn it, but that we're going to live into it, that we're going to live like it. We're going to live
as though we believe the words we affirmed earlier in that affirmation of faith. Because if we live that way,
we change. Our families change, our homes change, our schools and our workplaces and our government and our nation changes. And your kingdom comes.
Maybe not all at once.
Maybe not as quickly as I'd like it or we'd like it. But your timing is perfect.
Your provision is perfect.
And your protection is enduring. Lord, just help us today to live like we really believe it. To carry it with us out these doors to a broken world and point people to you. Because, Lord, that's what disciples do. We hear it, we learn it, but it isn't for us. We need to take it out there and live it amongst the people. Lord, help us to do that. Help us to be those kind of disciples, we pray. Disciples who are bold enough to pray along with your very first disciples. The prayer gets off that. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power,
and invite our ushers to come up as we receive our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings this morning. As they're coming up and going amongst you, I just remind you that our mission of the month, all of our mission giving, is directed into the Back Mountain Food Pantry. You can donate financially, you can bring food, you can volunteer to work. They need help from us this month and every month. So as you look at your giving this month, certainly we need your support for the budget of this church.
but your mission giving the extra mile given can go to the food pantry, which we're blessed to house over in our educational room. Thank you for all you do and for being who you are. God, you have indeed filled your lives with more blessings than we can even comprehend. This morning in these plates with our electronic giving and all the ways we give, we return a portion of those financial blessings to you, asking simply that you use these gifts, our lives, and this church to make a difference in the world. Lord, help us to do that. Help us to be that. Help us to live that, we pray. We ask all this in your name. Amen. I think I'm inviting our choir and our spirit singers and whoever else has the music to come on up and sing for you. Oh, and we have a special guest at the microphone, Don Tilly, joining us this morning.
Thank you.
big round of applause. He's been with us all around the world. We appreciate the music. Some of you taking the summer off. We do really appreciate all that you do. You add so much. Dr. Steve, thank you for your direction as well.
Yes,
yes, yes. So we have four of our confirmants who are reading. What I'm going to ask is that the mentor has one more job. You hold the microphone close to them, okay? Tyler, you're going to hand the microphone then. Who's the second reader? The hand? No, Stephen, second reader. Third reader then is Hannah and Ray McCrupp. It couldn't work that much better. So again, if the conference or the mentor could hold the microphone right there to their face.
When the day of the Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues, as of fire, appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages, as the Spirit gave them ability. Now they were devout Jews from every people under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language?"
All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Fellow Jews and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel."
"In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women in those days, I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness, and the moon to blood, before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved."
"Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, 'Brothers, what should we do?' Peter said to them, 'Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, so that your sins may be forgiven, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you, for your children, and for all who are far away, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to him.' And he testified of many other arguments and exhorted them, saying, 'Save yourself from this corrupt generation.' So those who welcomed his message were baptized, and that day about 3,000 persons were added. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. The word of God for the people."
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Can you pause with me for a moment of prayer? Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of each of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. This was one of those challenging preaching Sundays for me, because there was so much I wanted to say. But God revealed to me three words yesterday. It's going to be a little longer than three words. The first word is change. And to me, Peter is the perfect representative of the change that God's Spirit brings in our lives. And you all remember Peter. We journeyed with Peter throughout the season of Lent, through Easter, beyond Easter a little bit. And even last week, we shared in the ascension of Jesus. We saw Peter in his life of chutes and ladders, right? Times when it was like you hit the ladder and things seemed to be going exactly as Peter wanted them, and other times when he hit one of the chutes and did something that he probably shouldn't have done. What's amazing is that I think back when we began with the disciple Peter at the very beginning of that sermon series, I asked you as a congregation some of the things that you think about when you think about Peter, or some of the words you would use to describe Peter. And I certainly remember some of those. Impetuous, flawed, one who makes a lot of mistakes then too. But also one that Jesus saw something in. So much so that at his calling, he renamed Peter. Remember Peter's first name? Compliments? Right, Simon. Good. Simon. Simon was his first name. And yet, when God called him, God changed his name to Peter, which was the Greek word for rock. Upon you, Peter, I will build my church. Jesus saw something in Peter. And then we journeyed with Peter to the lowest of lows. And folks, that's the service you all did a great job leading us in. When we saw Peter deny Jesus, even after he swore to Jesus, Lord, I will never let you down. Lord, I'll be with you right to the very end. And yet, after Jesus was arrested, taken away to the courtroom, just outside of the courthouse, Peter was asked three different times by three different individuals, aren't you one of them? Weren't you with him? And each time, Peter said, I do not know the man. And the third time, what happened? That was my worst imitation. The cock crowed. And we focused on that Luke passage, which seems to be the only gospel passage where it looks as if Jesus and Peter at the time of the cock crow make eye contact with each other. Can you imagine that glance and that feeling with Peter? So Peter journeys from all of these chutes and ladders, so to speak, to today's passage of Scripture. He's gathered with the disciples. There's still some fear. There's still some questions. There's still some doubt. They're meeting behind closed doors, probably locked doors. There's some fear because some of those who put Jesus to death were still out to get others that believed in Jesus. And yet, suddenly, there's a sound like a rush of a mighty wind, and the Holy Spirit descended like a dove upon each of them. And these disciples then publicly began to proclaim the good news of Jesus in languages in which they were not trained. And then when the people who gathered there suggested, don't pay any attention to them, they're drunk, that's when Peter stood up and spoke on their behalf. This same flawed, impetuous, mistake-ridden Peter, the one who had hit that ultimate low, now changed by God's Holy Spirit, speaks in a bold and public way. Some of those words, committed, bold, even brazen. And it says at the end of that passage, the passage that Brady read, that they were cut to the heart when they heard Peter and this message. The Holy Spirit not only changed Peter, but the Holy Spirit changed all of those who were gathered there. And they said, what should we do? And Peter said, repent and be baptized, every one of you. And on that day alone, 3,000 church was never again the same. Folks, I want you to know that same Holy Spirit is present with us today. And all we have to do is yield ourselves to God's Spirit. Let God's Spirit change us. And then watch and see the difference that God makes in the world. The second word I want to share with you is growth. And to do that, I want to talk a little bit about the difference between monument and milestone. So when I think of monument, these are some of the things I think about. It's a picture of Washington's monument, a picture of the monument, which is at the Kingston Armory. That's for the 109th Field Artillery Battalion Monument. It's in memory of those that died in the train accident in Conshocton. If you recall, as a congregation, just last week, we remembered two of our own members who were a part of that train accident back several years ago. And then I thought more personally, the monuments that we make for our loved ones, too. That's my mother's monument and my dad's name there as well. Monument is a structure that was explicitly created to commemorate a person or event. It's believed to have come from the Albanian word, which is translated remember. And then there's a milestone. The dictionary definition of a milestone is this: a stone functioning as a milepost, a significant event or stage in the life progress, development, or the like of the person. Up in the top right-hand corner is one of those mile markers from the Roman Empire. That's really where it's believed that it started, because if you recall the Roman Empire, if you read anything about that, they built 53,000 miles of road, and then they marked them every so many steps, every mile, so that people would know how far they've come and how far they have yet to go. The milestone that's to the bottom right-hand corner is actually one that I was drawn to. One of our favorite places as a family is the Black Shannon State Park. And my shortcut to the Black Shannon State Park is Route 504, which happens to be also known as Rattlesnake Pike. It's called that way because it goes like this up a hill on the way to Black Shannon State Park. But I was always intrigued with this marker. I didn't have any idea what it was. It was a stone that had some kind of a boundary around it. And then I realized what they were. Again, a mile marker, marking the way. And I found out that this 24-mile section of the road was part of a larger state road, the historic 1799, which connected Philadelphia with Erie. One corner with the other. And it was an important thoroughfare during the War of 1812 when mail and goods traveled back and forth between the two. Many of these milestones are from the early 1800s. And of course, we see the one that we see on the highway today. So again, the difference. A monument is generally geographically located. It's meant to recall something historically, and a monument becomes a place to visit. It's a destination. It's an end point of a journey where one can reflect on the moment remembered or the person who is memorialized. But a milestone, marks the journey. It's just one marker along the way. And the purpose of the milestone is to indicate how far one has come, how much one has grown, and how far one has yet to go. Growth. Understand the difference between monument and mile marker? My hope is that this confirmation service today will not be a monument, an endpoint, a destination for any one of you, but a mile marker. One more step in your journey of faith as you see where God is leading you, where God is directing you, where God is calling you into God's ministry. All of these events, we pray, are milestones for each of us as well. The third word I want to share with you is action. And the action is for each of you as confirmands, but for all of us as a congregation and all of us as believers in Christ. I would say that this is a critical juncture in the life of our congregation, the Troxville United Methodist Church. We've confirmed 11 of our youth. We have a 12th youth that went through the entire process but wasn't quite ready to make those vows. We pray for her and for her family as well. But there are, and as you saw, many younger siblings that were here as we shared in the children's moment. It's critical for us to continue to be engaged in children and youth and family ministry as a congregation. And so the action that's called upon is for all of us to be a part of that journey. Think about some of the things that you can do. Think about some of the ways God may be nudging you. Volunteer. Step out in faith. Let God be your guide. And all of us can do something. And a precious lady from a previous congregation, I saw her one time at the doorway. She was one of our shut-in members. But every single Monday morning, she would call the church office, and any of the names that we shared at our worship service, she got the name and address of them, each of them, and sent them a card letting them know that the church, she was praying for them. All of us can do something. So it might be sending a card or a note, attending one of the sporting events or other activities that these kids are participating in, volunteering when we need help with vacation Bible school, stepping up when we need some leadership for Sunday school, helping out the providing transportation or making refreshments for any youth activities or children activities that we may have. There are all kinds of ways that we can be involved, and it calls for action on our part. And my challenge to each of you, we ended very intentionally with the spiritual gifts inventory. And I hope that was a great experience for each of you as, in just some small way, you were able to identify some of the gifts that God has given you. And to me, that's just one of the ways in which you can think about God leading you into ministry. Use those gifts that God has given you in ways that will bring about God's kingdom here on earth. To walk in faith, but you refused and made me wait. You disobeyed, you would not grow. That walk of faith you would not know. So I got tired, I got fed up, and there I dropped you on your butt. Because in life there comes a time when one must fight and one must climb, when one must rise and take a stand, or leave their butt prints in the sand. Inactivity is not acceptable. There's something that all of us can do. Let's pray. Lord, again, we thank you for the privilege of gathering here, sharing in this time of worship. We thank you for your powerful presence and call, Lord, on your Spirit to change us. And Lord, help us to continue to grow. Grow into the people you call us to be. And Lord, help us to always seek ways to actively engage in mission and ministry in this congregation and beyond. For these things, Lord, we do ask in your name. Amen. You'll notice the tune to the Alaskan. Let these words speak to you. It's in your red hymnals, number 555. You all need to kind of look at that then. I invite you to stand if you are able and sing. Forward through the ages.
Thank you.
County. They support foster and adopted families with resources, with meals, with money, with whatever they need to make that transition from the kids and the families a meaningful one. In the golf tournament yesterday, I couldn't go, but they made t-shirts with their tagline on it. And I was thinking about it as Jay was sharing those three words. Because their tagline is, "What's your something? What's your something? Y'all got a something. Your something's different than mine, is different than Dr. Steve's. And that's okay. That's the beauty of the church together." So you think about change, action, and growth. Change, growth, and action. What's your something? Because what happens is as you change, you grow. As you grow, you're encouraged into action. Do you know what that action does? It changes you, and you grow some more. Then you go act some more. Then it goes back again and again. That's the journey. That's the milestone. We're not building monuments. We're putting down milestones. What's your something? Go find it. Go do it. Go be it. To the glory of God. And as you go out there and find it and do it and be it, do it knowing that God Himself loves you more than you'll ever know or understand. And there's nothing you can do about it. Except go tell somebody else and share it with them. So go do that something today and every day. And all God's people said, amen. As Dr. Steve shares our postlude, we've had our confirmands and mentors to process out onto the sidewalk so y'all can greet them after the worship service. You all can be seated while the postlude is happening and they process out.